quiz, a little 5-10-question quiz. And if you get the majority of the questions right, you get put into a drawing for an iPad mini. That's the commercial. It gives me great pleasure now to introduce Chris Miller, our next speaker. Chris is president of Pacific Store Design. He's been a speaker for us for, I think, at least the last 5 years, and a frequent speaker in the industry at other shows. Chris knows what he's speaking about. He doesn't just talk about it. He actually designed stores. He's done over 3,000 store designs in his 31-year career. So you will learn a bunch of stuff from Chris today, and I'm going to turn things over to him. Chris?
Thank you, Steve. Give Steve a hand there, everybody. Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. Let's try it again. Good afternoon.
Hello.
Much better. This is an interactive session. My job is to make sure a little thing that doesn't kick in after lunch. It's called TEGO, T-E-G-O. And it stands for, after you have a big lunch and they dim the lights and we do the little presentation, this doesn't happen. It's a trainer's worst nightmare. And it stands for the eyes glaze over. So, my job is to move around a lot. I'm not nervous. It's just the way I keep the energy up in the room and offer questions and answers. I'll be available afterwards. I have a booth on the floor. You're welcome to come down and sign up for free appointments or just stop by and say hi. You're welcome to call me. My cell phone is on the handout on the last page. You can read about my bio. I'm very approachable. I'm here to help. And that's all I can say is we're going to have a great time this afternoon. How about that?
Woo-hoo.
All right. So, everybody get a handout?
Yes.
Okay, good. Everybody got a exit survey? Please fill that out at the end. We want to know what you liked, what you didn't like, and any ideas that you might have. It's about giving more of what you want and less of what you don't want, just like retailers when customers come into your store. What's the number one reason why you come to the show? To learn and see something new. New products. To learn and see something new. Why does a customer come to your store? Right. When was the last time you changed your store for that very reason? Some people do it as part of their culture. Some people never do it. It's the same piece of furniture as they walk in and walk out. We're going to talk a lot about change and ways to do it, from low cost to medium, all kinds of ideas. But this session is driven for lower cost ideas. I'm also doing a session tomorrow morning at 9:30 to 11 that's going to have a lot more expensive ideas and still some other ideas, but it's going to talk about complementing a good foundation, what we're going to talk about today. We're going to talk a little bit more about store design tomorrow. We're going to talk about lighting tomorrow. We're going to talk about how to do end cap and wow displays and windows a little bit more than what we're going to do today. So they both are going to complement each other. There's probably about 10% overlap because I have a foundation I like to set that's setting the foundation for any good building. You got to have a good foundation. And it's a common cause to doing business. So let's start out with the one thing that you'd like to get out of this session. We have a fairly small group, which is good. One thing that you'd like to get out of this session. Anybody have something specific to them that I might be able to expand on a certain portion of these ideas that we're going to talk about? And don't be afraid, because this is interactive, and I pick on the people in the back row. Yes, one thing that you'd like to get out of the session. Mapping? When you say mapping, how? Moving accessories to the back? Oh, necessities, sure, absolutely. We're going to talk about how to locate traffic flow by department or category. Okay? We're going to talk about that today. Good. We're going to talk about a lot tomorrow.
I guess converting those people who come and browse and leave with nothing in their hands to somebody.
Okay? We're going to talk about how to convert today. This is a great session for that. I've added some new stuff. How many people have seen me speak before? Okay, we're going to have new stuff this time. Some really new stuff. And it's going to be great because it's stuff you can take back and implement. It's called How to Build an ABCD Team and How to Sell Different Personalities and How to Convert Browsers into Buyers. Okay? We had another question back there I didn't get a chance to answer. Something that you wanted out of the session? I saw two hands. Yes. Increase sales. Well, we're going to have lots of ideas. Okay. Plus sales. Anybody else? Space-saving ideas. Guess what? We're going to have that as part of this session. It's called How to Get 100 Pounds of Groceries in a 10-Pound Sack. I actually did that session a few years back for SuperZoo and in a couple other industries, and it was called How to Get 100 Pounds of Bandini in a 10-Pound Sack. And nobody knew what Bandini was because it's not an East Coast thing. It's a West Coast thing, which is manure. Anyways, so everybody's like, what's Bandini? I'm like going, it's manure, dude. So I didn't even do my research on that one. Didn't do a very good job. Somebody else had one thing they wanted to get out of the session? Yeah.
How do you compete against Amazon.com?
How do you compete against Amazon.com? Wow, that's a tough one. Tomorrow, we're going to talk about that. But I'm going to address, I'll just give you a couple pointers. What is a retail store? It's an experience.
Personal experience.
It's a place where people go to get entertained, to be able to feel in touch and learn. 12% of the population buys for price and price only. One of the biggest problems we have right now in retail is back in 1980, believe it or not, the average shopping experience was 90 minutes from the time they left their front door to the time they came back home. Guess what it is today? 22 minutes. And they hit five or six stores during that whole time on their way home. I hit sometimes three or four places on my way home, and I live a half hour from work, and I get it done in an hour. Because it's not you have all these specialty niches that you have to hit because they can't get what I want in one place. To answer your question is 59% of the population buys from some other reason than price, service and selection. They're willing to spend 15% more. And 29% most of the time is willing to spend 15% more. I shop at Amazon because when I'm busy, I'm a busy person and I have a lot of time on my hands. I did all my Christmas shopping very quickly. I went to several retailers that didn't have what I wanted. I put Google it up, there it was. Clicked on the free shipping, those people show up. They're doing a better job at getting products in people's hands. But a retail store is nothing more than a distribution center. What is Amazon.com? A distribution center. You're distributing products to consumers. You have to do a better job. And I'm going to tell you a few things along the way, and maybe you can start seeing how can I mold my store to cater to the people that want to shop my store. Okay? I like to shop local if I can. I make a point of it, but if they don't have what I want, where do I go? I got to get what I want. So supplying needs, listening to your customers. Keyword, listening to your customers. But that's a great question. So I think I could probably spend all day on that. And I'd have to learn your store. And it's like, okay, we're going to do these 20 things. And these 20 little things are going to make up to be a big thing because people are going to start getting it. Okay? It exists, and we have to do the best thing we can. And if anybody has suggestions how they're... I have one store that put a big banner up, We Match Internet Prices. And guess how much... Over a month, they might match $1,500 worth, but they did $60,000 that much. It's not a lot. People don't have time to do all that research. There's a lot of people that do, though. And that's a culture that's coming. It's called a neo-shopper. And we're going to talk about that tomorrow. Okay? So it gives you a reason to come back tomorrow. See? Anybody else have one thing that they'd like to get out of the session? Yeah. Okay? Sell products with higher margin. We could play a little game right now. Ear mite drops. For dog's ears, ear mite drops. Everybody write down what they sell it for. Write it down on your thing. Okay, who came? Just give me some prices.
$7.99.
Anybody over here have a price?
$11.99.
$10.99. If I sold it for $16.99, would I sell any less units over a year's period? The answer is no. As soon as it goes over a $20 price point, people go, wow, that's pretty spending for that little bottle, but I need it. At what point in time will they actually take out their phone and scan the barcode and look it up and see where they're going to get it? They need it now. The point is, people buy for different reasons. And every product in our store needs to have variable pricing structure. You don't throw all your collars and leashes at one price margin. You look at each individual product and each individual SKU to look at it in a way to squeeze as much margin out of every product you can. Is there price visible items in your store? Give me. Price visible. I mean price sensitive. Give me something that's price sensitive. Yeah. I had a store called Russo's, world's largest. They were in Newport Beach. They discounted everything. They had regular price, our price. They worked on really tight margins. Everybody came up to the thing and put it up there and go, man, your prices are high. Everybody complained. So we did, was you stopped discounting, raised all the prices, 20% right to the bottom line. People still came up and complained. You're a convenience store. Is a 12-pack of Coors Light at 7-Eleven more expensive than the supermarket? You expect to pay more, right? You're a convenience store. That's a key word, convenient. They call you by name when you walk in. You go get the food for them. Why don't you grab some can and some treats while I'm getting this for you? Can I carry it out for you? You know, that kind of service separates you from the competition. As soon as somebody gets something stolen off their doorstep at Amazon, which just happened to me.
Yep.
Guess what? I'm not going to shop at Amazon next year because of all the trials and tribulations I had. Had to send some stuff back. You know, it didn't really work out for me the way I wanted. It cost me probably $60 in money and 4 hours of aggravation. You know, I'm going to just I'm going to shop all year long and think it out a little bit better. But anyways, that's just me. I'm not saying everybody has to do that. So, where did the word retail come from? Anybody know where the word retail came from? How long have you been in business? How many years?
Two.
How many years?
34.
34 years. Where did the word retail come from? Everybody's in retail, but nobody knows why we're here.
Resale.
Re is a Latin derivative to do what?
Again.
To do over. Tale, art of telling stories, telling a tale. It got morphed over the years. Retail is the art of telling stories. Every product, every service in your store has to have a story behind it. Come on. We need to find ways to improve your operations. We have to have a better story. We have to have a better experience. We have to have knowledgeable staff. All of the information at this shell is amazing. The products. And then all that has to go into your brain. Then you got to take it back to the store and you have to simulate that to staff members. And that frontline person is your weakest link that's actually talking to the customer, if it's not yourself, if you have a staff. So where do we need to invest our effort? Is that person that's pressed in the flesh with that customer? Can we do things that the big boys can't? Can we come up with ideas that the big boys can't? Can we call them by name? Can we have a sign that says, cell phone service. They can actually sit in their car, call the store, and you can take it out to their car so they don't have to unload all the kids and bring it in. It's called breaking down the barriers of intimidation. Do we have an older neighborhood? 25% of the population is going to be over the age 65 in the next 5 years. That's one out of four people having to negotiate a heavy swinging door and a bag of dog food in a cart. Isn't it time for some power doors? How about larger labels? How about a magnifying glass on the shelf so people don't have to remember their glasses and pull it out and see what's on the shelf? How about non-skid floors, non-glare, creating layers of light so it's not so stark when they come from outside and they're having trouble focusing in on their products. What ideas or events can we do? That's what we're going to talk about in this session. How can we make a better retail shopping experience? My job as a consultant and as a retail expert is to find ways to get to separate customers from their wallet. It's called a McAdon, right? 75% of retail is impulse. Bank of America publishes that every year. It's gone down to as low as 66%. But when you go on, even when you shop online, look how many impulse buys there are around. Other people were shopping for this. And it just, when did you ever put two things that related to each other and put it on an end cap? When have you ever grouped things together? When was the last time you used a mannequin that not only had a collar, but it had a shirt, it had matching booties, and it had a stroller that matched and did the whole package? When have you ever, you go into these stores, it's a sea of merchandise. We're going to talk about how to differentiate our store from other stores. Now, the question is what stores do you like to shop and why? Doesn't have to be a pet store. What stores?
I hate clothing shopping. I call ahead to my favorite boutique. They have everything ready to go. I show up and I'm there for 15 minutes.
You go to a small independent that doesn't waste your time, knows your size, knows your style, lays all the clothes. You can get in there, they can throw them over the door. You can try on your stuff and you walk out of there. You probably walk out of there a whole lot less in your wallet than you when you walked in with.
There's a lump in my throat after what I pay, but it's worth it.
Okay. If I have a story to tell, remind me to tell the Home Depot story if we have time at the end. Because it's a funny, funny story. I love telling it. But anybody else have a favorite store in the way they like to shop there? So she shops there because of time. It's easy, convenient, and they have, well, obviously they have what she wants. So the selection. What's your favorite store and why you like to shop there?
The Apple Store.
Apple Store. Why?
Because you can try everything else.
So it's interactive. I want to talk about interactive selling when we get to the selling part. Yeah? Okay, so friendly staff. Friendly staff. The big guys can't do that, can they? Easy to shop. Okay? Any other stores, your favorite store, and why you like to shop there? We're missing a couple items I want to get on here. Value. Right? Why do people buy? There's two reasons why people buy. Make them feel good or not to feel bad. My wife, I'll give you an example. We're going over to Disneyland. And we're at Epcot. What do you want for lunch, honey? So, I don't know. What do they have? We have to walk the entire loop. And she has to find every flavor. And then she has to make a decision. Because she doesn't want to feel bad and have something to eat. And turn around and go, oh, we should have ate there. We go into a restaurant, I said, go find your seat, I'll be here, just call me when you've found it. Because wherever we sit, we're going to have to move three times. Okay? People buy for different reasons. When that cart's coming down the aisle and you're looking at that food going, am I going to feel better because I ate it or worse afterwards? People buy for different reasons. Mostly to feel good, but some people don't want to feel bad. Value. Target, well lit, easy to shop, very good signage. Easy to navigate, clean, that's another word. I can talk about this stuff all day long, we'll run out of time. I gotta go through quite a bit. These are all integral parts of a positive buying experience. And I tell you, your store cannot be too clean. I have stores that there's a scuff mark. While they're talking to a customer, they're going like this with their foot, rubbing out that scuff mark. They always have a wet towel over their shoulder. And they're cleaning all the time. We'll talk about a cleaning schedule. I think we're going to talk about the Ten Commandments today. I think so. We're going to talk about the Ten Commandments. Good. Come on. Come on. We're going to talk about how to be retail ready. Might have to do it by hand. And there's one important thing I'd like you to get out of my session today. Does anybody have a guess on what that might be?
Never be complete.
Close. But it's called having a good, positive attitude. If there's anything that you take away from this session, it is a new sense of enthusiasm and positive attitude. I'd like everybody in this room to repeat after me, I feel terrific, on three. One, two, three.
I feel terrific.
Not quite good enough. I want the people in that session, the people down on the floor, wishing they were in this session because we're having a great time. On three. One, two, three.
I feel terrific.
What's happening? Everybody's sitting up in their chairs. Tego's not sitting in the back row. I've done my job, but we all are smiling. It's very contagious. How many people have customers that are negative and staff members that are negative, that just suck the wind out of you? Negative, 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 negative. I was in a store consulting, and this manager, gosh, I couldn't believe it. I said, excuse me. I walked him over, and the owners were there, and I walked him over, and I put my arm around him. And I says, does anything nice come out of your mouth? He goes, what do you mean by that? And I go, you're a downer, dude. Negative, negative, negative. Any suggestion I had, you found five reasons why you couldn't do it. And I'm saying, you got to be thinking about how you can get things done. When I was growing up, and what we did in my table, my family, is we all had to say three nice things as we went around the table. The positive things that happened to him during the day. And you know, you're only eating dinner for so long, and before you know it, we're all the way around the table, and boom, dinner's over with. And whenever I caught one of my twin daughters being a little bit negative, I go, Rachel, it's a glass half full or half empty. She goes, Daddy, it's overflowing. And there's a reason for it, because it basically triggers and it's contagious. It's like a guy that goes down to hunt down Moby Dick and takes tartar sauce with him. Is that a guy with a good positive attitude and enthusiasm? So if there's anything I can give you, please take back a new positive attitude and all this enthusiasm and do something in your store. Why create change? Why should we create change in our store?
To get people excited.
To get people excited. Whenever you move something in a store, and people go, when did you start carrying those? Like 10 years ago, we just moved 10 feet. Where have you been? Has anybody moved the product in your store? People are like, when did you start carrying that? Yeah. The only given in retail is change. 10% product out, 10% in. People want to see something new and different. All right, we talked about the first 20% attitude. And then I've expanded this to my other four areas of a retail store. Four specific areas in which a customer shops your store that you're exposed to. Philosophically, when I go out to see a store, these are four things that I look at when I consult and I look. And I want to turn you guys into mini pros on this, okay? What do you think those four things that a customer is exposed to?
Cleanliness.
It's part of one of these items. Close. What do you think they are? How about the outside? Curb appeal. Write that down. Traffic flow starts outside. People start to form an opinion in the first 28 seconds from the time they see your sign, slow down, pull into your parking lot, see your storefront, see the trash, cigarette butts, they see the 10K run with scotch tape on the window. They see the little sign that slides back and forth, the little tiny push things that they can't read because of the glare in the window. They see all the banners and stuff that you've got accumulated over the years and the dead bugs in the corner. They notice this stuff. How about a door that's propped open with a big neon bone sign that says open, and they got a nice carpet with your logo that says, "And we may your pet enjoy good health always." You know, how about some window displays that have movement or fun and different? How about nice clean storefront that's been policed with no trash? Nice clean windows that are clean.
Plants.
No dead plants. God, I go in so many stores of dead plants. I'm nursing them back to health. I go, do it at home. Good Lord, it's amazing.
And how about outdoor plants?
Nice outdoor plants, we're going to...
Nice plants. Mm-hmm. Pretty color.
How about topiary?
Yes.
Topiary. A plant carved in the shape of an animal. Universal language. Is that good, curb appeal?
Yes.
We're going to talk about curb appeal. How about something else, too, that people are exposed to in your store?
Odors.
When they walk in... They see the inside of the store, and they smell the inside of the store, so we got the store interior, the store experience. Once you walk through the exterior, you walked into the interior. So we're going to talk about some low-cost ideas and ways to create a better atmosphere when we shop. So we got the outside, and we got the inside. What do you think the next one is? People, staff, absolutely. Because they're going to have to interact with staff at some point of the deal. Hopefully more than not more. And not the death question. Hi, may I help you? No, thanks, I'm just looking. You're going to get that answer every time. So what I do is I say, great, my name's Chris. Shake their hand, put my arm around. Come on, let me show you around then. If you're just looking, let me show you around. Not the best, but it works. My favorite line ever in the whole wide world, I was at a store, and I was killing time because the owner was still with a rep, and I came over next door, and it was a jewelry store, and it was getting close to Valentine's Day, and I'm sort of kicking tires, killing time in there. And she says, you know, our best sellers are the one I get to take out of the case and show you. I spent $400 there. Great line. Great opening line. And what do you think the other one is? There's one more we haven't touched on. Close, but let's talk about merchandise. Merchandising. Come on. Might need to put a battery in here. Outside, first impression. I'm just going to go manual. Merchandising, product appeal, and staff. Education and change your store culture. These are all integral parts of a great buying experience. Don't just go back into your store and try one thing. Look at the big picture, the umbrella effect. What am I going to do in all these different areas to make my shopping experience the best possible for the customers that come in my store? Okay, curb appeal. What do we instantly know about this retail experience? Preconceived notions. Stinks. What else? Crappy. Okay. It's going to be claustrophobic.
Smells.
What else?
Dark.
Spiders in the corner. It's going to be dark.
Limited inventory.
Probably not a lot of toilet paper. They're going to be little squares, right?
Outdated.
Does the lock work? It's cramped. And you're probably going to want to spend the least amount of time in this retail establishment. Now, you formed that opinion just by the curb appeal. Now, is it possible, however unlikely, that we have a ceramic tile interior, heated floor, subfloor, environmental aroma, music, padded seat, your favorite magazine, you know, soft mood lighting, and your favorite two-ply toilet paper? Is it possible?
Yeah.
Highly unlikely, though. So don't underestimate the power of good curb appeal. Traffic flow starts outside. How about this retail establishment? Instant first impression. Clean. It's a dog and a cat combination logo. It's up in Eagle, Idaho. And they went with a sort of a lodge craftsman theme. How about this store? A little hard to see the sign because they're set back so far. But they have movement with the banners. Not expensive. How about your store sign professionally printed so you can pull up when it's 27 below with a wind chill of 42 and you don't have to get out of your car to find out what time I can come back here tomorrow? Vinyl decal in the window. On the outside of the window, not the glare from it being inside the window. Because if you have your store hours inside, during the day, you can't see it. So this is on the outside of the store, professionally printed, easy to read. Just remember, an inch and a half letter is readable from 50 feet in Helvetica medium block. They have readability indexes. You can Google up readability index. Will tell you the height of the letter, the contrast, and how far somebody with 20/20 vision can see that letter. The same with the sign on the building. You have to be able to see those letters. A 12-inch letter is readable from 300 feet. 3-foot high letters readable from 900 feet. The door's propped open. Everything's ventilated out of this place. We have environmental aroma coming in. There's background music. It's a positive buying experience. Neon open sign in the shape of a bone. If you're so far away you can't see open, but you can see the bone, what do you instantly think? Pet store that sells food. That simple. Universal language. And the window displays are rolling. I got a better picture of them also from the inside. And there's the Lucky Dogs storefront. But you notice all the glass, it's very glary during the day. They do make a glass called Schott glass, S-C-H-O-T-T. It's a non-reflective glass. You would see into the store, you would not see any reflections. If you put it side by side, you would bet your house payment there was not glass right here with Schott glass. It's amazing. It's a layered glass. It comes from Germany. But having good curb appeal and readability index, they were set off the street, I think it was about a 20-inch high letter. It's readable not only from the street light, it's really close to the second street light that's way down. And it's backlit, so it glows like an icon on the corner from the highest cross-section where the traffic stack is. These are the same rolling displays on the window on the inside. So you can roll them around your store, and you have a backdrop so the window doesn't get cooked with the sun coming in and baking all the stuff in the window. Some other things you can do in a window is just cut out the silhouette of an animal, paint it a bright color, and put a black light on it. And you don't have to worry about it getting cooked during the day with all the sun, depending on which facing you are. North, not an issue. But if you're southwest or eastern, southeast facing, you're going to get lots of sunshine. So these little rolling displays we did for Global Pet Foods. And they do quite a bit of business with their air miles. Or movement. How about a treadmill with a dog in the window? When was the last time you walked into a store and laughed? So little points. Oversized graphics, neon silhouettes. You could do big neon silhouettes of animals. Exterior sign is large enough to read. Window displays clean, fun, inviting. Prop the doors open, weather permitting. People can spot a door wide open far further than they can a sign. And then, have you ever noticed when people start in your store, walking in, and it starts getting busy, it attracts other people? They come in waves. It's like they're like bugs. It's amazing. So a drive-by window might be large and charged, so it gets your attention as you drive by, not so much a walk-by window. And you can, believe it or not, the ones I'm going to show tomorrow were paid by the manufacturers. He got his dog food racking for free, and he got his window graphics for free. Paid by the dog food guys. So, can happen. I went back. Walk-by windows. You want to be able to tell a story. You don't want to have too many buying decisions, but you want to try something different and fun. It could be something as a pig in a window. It doesn't have to relate to your business, something to make people laugh. Mannequins, the non-reflective glass we talked about, but you can also put a backdrop. Does anybody have problems with trying to get more space in your store? Okay, talk to the right crew. A lot of times, especially if you're a destination store and or walk-by windows will typically do this. Then we'll have an entrance, and we'll have a pedestal here, and this creates a backdrop for doggy mannequins or whatever, for like a walk-by window. This is all open glass, so they can still see in your store, and then we have some downlighting, and we do the same thing on this side. So it still has the vision in, but we've got product that's not competing with the product inside. It has a backdrop. So you have this area to still see in, you still have lots of natural light coming through. On the reverse side, what you have is extra display space, because we can have slot wall here, and we can have products all through here. Here's our entrance. And then again, we can have all this extra display space that we weren't getting. And then this product doesn't get cooked by the sun. So you can create some space. And this only has to be about 18 inches or so off the window. And it's a framed wall with slot wall on it. Nothing exciting. Create some extra wall space. You can go further. If you're a destination store, heck, you can put graphics in the window or just put fixtures across, because you're a destination store. You know, walk by, your window displays aren't going to do anything for you. Got a couple. Curb appeal walk-by displays. I was in Vegas at Super Zoo and was walking the show, and they had these, they put duck legs or whatever you want to call it on their purses, and the lady was taking the purses for a walk. Isn't that cool? And then the eggs were cracked open, and they had belts and stuff, but you could do the same thing with your products, like doggy toys inside the eggs or treats or things like that. Just something creative. See with how much glare you get during the day? But at night, you pump some light onto that display, and it looks quite enticing. But look what happens with all the glare during the day. Okay, some low-cost ideas. How can we create a better retail mousetrap? We are at top of page 4. How many people here can afford fresh coat of paint? Raise your hand. Okay? Now you couple this with the Ten Commandments of Merchandising, and I guarantee you, you will see at least a 10% increase in sales. Has anybody recently painted your store? What were the results of that?
Awe.
Awe.
It was drastically different.
People walk in, they stop right in there, and they go, you guys grew, right? How about over here? What did they say? Wow. Did they spend more time in the store? Did they see more merchandise? Did your sales go up? Fresh coat of paint. Everybody can afford a fresh coat of paint. If you don't like the color, guess what? Paint's cheap. You can repaint it. Try dark ceiling. Try something different. Try something different. I have a store. They say, oh, my ceiling's too low. It's only 10 feet. Why are we painted out charcoal? Trust me. 3,000 stores painted out charcoal. It's going to look great. We had another store. Had really, really low ceilings. I want really good lighting, but it's too stark. I said, flip the light over and shine it up at the ceiling. Let it reflect down. What a great idea. Now it doesn't feel so claustrophobic because we have lights on our eyes. Now it's this nice soft halo effect. So there's always solutions. Just trying to come up with great ideas. Here's a tip. I think, I don't know if it's on here or it's coming up. Sometimes I squeeze it in. Guess not. But look at this archway we painted. This is an Art Deco type look. We just painted this little, trimmed it out and painted an archway. So it was an Art Deco kind of look in that store. And just a little faux painting, and we had a lot of little design credit. Here's another tip. You can raise all your prices 2% without affecting sales. That means if you're doing $1 million a year, that's a $20,000 increase in bottom line profit. We talked about variable pricing structures. Here's a story. Does anybody sell millet in your store? How many people sell millet? Is millet price sensitive? No? A lot of people, you say it is. Because it's in a little box. You cut it up with a box cutter, $5 with the grease pin. You know, baggies, and people buy it all day long, right? So a couple boxes a week, right? Everybody said, oh, mullets, you know, everybody buys it all the time. It's price sensitive. No. Let's put it in a nice little plastic container with tongs and a little professionally made sign. It says, fresh millet, great for baby bird digestive systems and a great treat for all birds. 59 cents a spray. Sales went up. Sales doubled. Because we had it at eye level in a nice container with tongs, a little roller. We put a sign behind it. We got that price point up to $1.19 each. Four cases, five cases a week. We brought it down to $1.09, and we asked people, why do you sell millet? Why do you buy millet from us? We're the most expensive in town. Oh, you have the freshest millet in town. It's a weed. It's a year old. So it's about creating a story, show respect for the merchandise, and try something new and different. That's the key here. Try something new and different. Matching fixtures and wheels on your displays. I have three things that I like to use in retail, especially pet stores. Stainless, wheels, and ventilation if you have pets in your store. Those three things are really good things to have because they last a long time and it smells good in your store and it gives you the ability to change. Getting the right fixture for the right job. How many people get fixtures behind the supermarket on these old card racks or shelves that are this big and you got product on the edge just because you got it free and it doesn't match your store or it's busy or it's not adjustable? And we also want to have a store that's billboard. That first third of the store needs to be low. Then you can go a little higher in the back and then highest in the back wall. Billboard your store. People have a problem with space. We talk a lot about space tomorrow. And then eliminate your point of purchase displays, your little freebie displays. We call them graphic pollution, visual train wreck. Get rid of all those banners, get rid of all the graphics in your store, and start from scratch. Fresh coat of paint, and then start merchandising your store. And then create graphics that are the universal language that matches. So now we have a thing called decor. But we got to have a baseline. We don't want to have a visual train wreck in our store. How about conversation peoples that people remember? Does anybody have a conversation thing that they have or a unique item that's unique to your store? Okay, so you have, look for the bearded dragon on the propane tank and people remember that icon. So it differentiates you from everybody. You need to have a conversation piece in your store. A wow factor when you first walk in. There's a decompression zone in the front of the store. It's 9x9. And the reason is people usually come in by themselves or with somebody and they take three steps. And they stop and they go, and they look left and right. Or the right to left. That's their little comfort zone. And a lot of stores you walk in, it's like, there's the closeout table, and I already feel like I don't want to shop here. 80% of the population suffers from some type of claustrophobia. And get in an elevator. What happens? Everybody clams up. As soon as they come out of there, everybody talks. What we want to do is create some type of a circular flow in our store because 80% of the customers go to the right. Then we want to get them back to that high foot traffic item, the dog food in the back, if you carry dog food or whatever your high traffic item is. Get in the back, and then they turn right, and they come out of the store, different aisle, not the same one, and they get up to your checkout counter. So our number one foot traffic item needs to go in the back, center left. And then we want them to take a different path in and a different path out of the store. We want to create extra foot traffic. There's lots of ways to talk about store design tips, but if you can just think about how can I locate my product to get people to walk further. In a nutshell, I'm going to go into this really in depth tomorrow, is if we have a typical store, and people walk in, wherever it is, I call it the 180-degree rule. I want to have my number one foot traffic item here, so they go in, They go out, and we want to put the checkout in this quadrant. And the reason is, if we have the checkout in this quadrant, people walk in and you greet them, what happens? They go the other way, don't they? They go this way. Salesperson, right? If they shop your store all the time, they'll make a beeline back to that and a beeline back, but we don't want them to take the same aisle. We want them to see more merchandise. If we put the checkout here, or here, or here, 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 what happens is they go into the number one item, they come here, this becomes a dead zone. Anybody have dead zones in your store? Maybe because your checkout's in the wrong location. Can your checkout be here? Yes, it can, because you can force a reverse loop, and they'll go this way. This is the number one preference. This is number two. Number three would be in the middle and have an entrance here and an exit here. So they come in and have to go through your store that way. A lot of stores have a demising wall between with a couple openings. Keep dropping the lids. So anyways, that's the concept. So we have lots of end caps and a drive aisle that drives them past. So we have these categories, and we try and set things on an angle. Why would we do that? Can I see my hands? Can I see my hands now? People don't see it 90s, they see it 45s. So if we can set things at an angle to break up the lines in the store, we can then create some extra buying avenues. Sight lines are called. How about some space-saving ideas? Swinging panels. We do a swinging panel that's 20 inches by, these are shorter, 48s, but the 72 tall ones we make. But in that one section, we have 13 foot of display space in 4 feet. So it's a great way for items that are not impulse. People are going to browse through collars and leashes, or if you have any aquarium stores here, the meds, you know, going through the meds, all the little short hooks with the different meds on there, or anything small parts that you want to keep, you can actually condense a lot of space into a very small area. It's all about dollars per square foot. We don't rent square footage, we rent cubic feet. So this gives you a great way to add some selection to your store. Here's the taller version. And then also, see the radius shelf, how it sticks out? It catches your eye. See the radius shelf there? Just some tips. You can retrofit a section of your shelving. Collar and leash rack, tiered rack, where you can take and the leashes fall behind the next. Sliding panels, this one slides back and forth. So I just put 50% increase in my collar and leash section just by adding a sliding panel. Double sliders. Now I 100% increase. And a combination of hang bars and some manufacturer racks. Look how it's color blocked. See how the color blocking, how it's nice and simple to the eye? We're going to talk about that in the merchandising section. Just want to point that out. This slot wall on the back wall is aluminum slot wall. It's 1.5-inch groove centers, not 3-inch groove centers. How many people have a slot wall in your store? Okay, the best store fixture is one you can't see. More adjustability, ability to make the wall disappear. Is pegboard bad? Not if I can make it disappear, because it's 1 inch on center, 1 inch by 1 inch. The nice thing about slot wall, the grooves are easier on the eyes, it's not so busy. But I've done sets with pegboard, and you can virtually make it disappear with the right packaging. This one is, on the left, is a, actually it's a pet food merchandiser. We just finished a store up in Canada, eh? And if you look here, these three shelves, that's 4 feet wide. They're 16-inch shelves. And they're on a special bar. It's called a pet food merchandiser bar. This clips into an existing Logier system or any gondola system, like a Madex or a Logier. And now you can adjust your flavors of bags. If you have different bags, you're having trouble because you got to bury five flavors. You can have them staggered by flavor, or it works great for cat trees. Versus this way, with the old style racking, and you see the wasted space in there because you're locked in on your adjustability. Just a different way. But I was able to get more inventory in the same space. Different pet food, but you can stagger flavors by bag size. So you're not locking in this 8-foot shelf where you can only change an 8-foot shelf. You can change by section. Same concept, but more in a warehouse fixture. So again, a dog food set with cantilever type shelving and one with light duty warehouse shelving, we call multifunction or wide span. It is a thicker beam. So I'm losing 2.5 inches, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 times 2.5 inches. I get another shelf, don't I? And everybody get to that beam, you got a merchandise and you can't fit that bag in, don't have a problem with this. Guess what? The one on the right costs less. So we're retrofitting all the global stores over to gondola system. It has a built-in ticket molding too. Recessing the front of the counters for bulk displays, adding more selling space. Creating impulse panels around the checkout counter to cover up the back of the cash register and create more impulse selling areas up around the checkout. This is Cahoots. They've got a chain of stores in Southern California. And we build all their checkout counters and arbors and playpens and animal enclosures. Merchandising sweat equity is next up. However, we're going to talk about the 10 commandments for merchandising. And before we do that, I need everybody to stand up and stretch. Okay? The mind can only absorb as much as the behind can endure. So before we get to this, I'd like everybody to tell me, and if you feel like it, hopefully Tego's not setting in. One thing that you learned in this last 55 minutes. And one thing you learned that was new. Pain is cheap. Anybody learn something new?
Have a wow factor.
Have a wow factor. Be positive.
Biggest seller, back.
Number one, foot traffic. 180 degree rule. Center back.
Center.
Back a little bit left. Just a little bit left.
We have some beautiful windows that we're not using.
Great. Better window displays. Get a backdrop and then create some excitement there. Anybody learn something new? Everything's new. Just one thing. Anybody else want to share one thing they learned?
Huh?
13 feet into 4 feet. Go figure. All right. You can sit down now. We all ready to learn the next section? Do a stretch break about 40 to 50 minutes, because that's about when I start to get a little antsy and people in the back row start falling asleep. Got to wake them up. Okay, 10 commandments. Number one, clean your store. How important is clean your store? I'm going to give you some tips. It sounds simple, but you got to find a way to implement these things in your store when you go back. I say let's create a cleaning calendar. What you do on a piece of graph paper, or you can have somebody that's a draftsman, but draw your store out. And draw it in 4-foot increments. Whatever it is. This is WD1. What do you think WD1 means? Window display 1. Window display 2. How about over here? Focal point 1. End cap 3. End cap 1, 2, 3, 4. We might have a checkout display. We have CO3. We got wall 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. All the way around the store. You got gondola 1A, 1B. Gondola 2A, 2A. You get the point. Okay? Now we've given all this store a 4-foot module. And when they come in to punch in, guess what's on their time card? The manager says, you're cleaning gondola 3 today. 4-foot section, that's all I need you to do. Pull all the product down, wipe it all off with a wet cloth. Not the dust master, the duster. Why? Moves the dust around, doesn't it? Clean a 4-foot section. Now, if you say, I need you to do the shampoo section, and it might be 8, 10, 12 feet long, do you think it's going to happen during the day? No. So get them to clean a 4-foot module. Simple to do. It's a non-negotiable standard. They cannot go home until it's done. Guess what? They will get it done before they go home. I like to do a little 3x5 card. I'm going to save that when I finish this. I'm going to save that. Get my clicker. Face in front, number 2. Face in front with 2 hands. Continually, all the time. And that means we want to bring the product right out to the edge of the shelf, spin the label, and put it out front. And if I'm selling in the store and somebody comes in for some shampoo or ear mite drops, I go like this, either on a hook or a shelf, and I hand it to the people, and they get it in their hand, and I go, this is the best product for you, and they're holding on to it. And I instantly go and I pull that product up to front. I face in front when I sell. Why do I do that? They can't put it back. And it's also telling them that's the right buying decision, isn't it? It's telling them subliminally, this is the right product for you. And I don't have to go back and reface in front. Teach your staff to face in front with 2 hands. I was in a store. I was waiting for the owner again with a rep. He said, I'll be right out. So I'm in the store. I'm doing this. And the people are looking at me in the store, and they're standing by the cash register like this, going, what's he doing? He must be a rep. And I, excuse me, can I help you, sir? I said, yeah, I'm just waiting for Hip, I think his name was, in the back. It's a Vietnamese fellow. I'm sitting there doing that. And I come out, I go, Hip, he says, you've been to my seminars. I go, look at this set. It looks like a war zone hit it. Oh, I just don't have time. I go, really? I go, what? Tell me what's going on in your place. And he's talking to me, and I'm doing this. Really? Uh-huh. Okay. I go, look at that. Who did that? And I said, I did it while I was talking to you. You either have it in your bones or you don't. I was raised in the grocery industry. And I'll tell you, if you're not doing something, you're fired. You're always doing something. If you ain't cleaning, you're not facing front, you're not cleaning a toilet, you're not cleaning a window. If you're not, if you're standing there occupying space, you are fired. That is non-negotiable. We are going to eat. We exchange paychecks for exceptional performance. Not average, exceptional performance as we change paychecks. It's either this is a sandbox, this is non-negotiable, or you will fire yourself. I'm not going to fire you, you're going to fire yourself. So on a 3x5 card, I have greet the customer with a smile. Be genuine. Number 1. If you're not greeting the customer, number 2 is you're facing and fronting. Number 3 is you're cleaning a 4-foot module. Number 4 is you're putting away inventory. Number 5 is, guess what? Go back to number 1. And if you're standing at the cashier occupying space and I catch you, guess what? You're not going to be working for me because I do not exchange paychecks for average. This is the slow list. This is the to-do list. I go into so many stores, guess what? I got 3 staff members behind the counter. People, when they shop, they will go to somebody that is busy before they will go to somebody standing behind the counter and ask a question. Number 5 is go back to number 1.
What was number 4?
Number 4 was put away inventory. It's in the notes section.
Okay.
Golly! I go a little bit fast.
Oh, it is. There it is. You thought of all of it.
What page? Back on back.
Right here. This one. Okay.
Okay, we're on page 3. Face in front. Now, if we're not facing and fronting, what we're doing, the next one is spread to fill. If we have an open section where this product sold out and we have two here, we go ahead and we face in front and double face. And people say, well, if I do that, then my tags run on my shelf. I say, well, you flip the tag over. That means you're out of stock. And another thing we'll talk about at the very end, how to remember what you did. You create a planogram that's very easy for your store. You don't have to have a planogram. But spread to fill. By double facing a product to the same SKU, where you only had one SKU before, sells 46% better. If you have a shampoo section, you people walk in, they see all these single facings of shampoo, and all of a sudden you got two. What do you instantly think about that one? It's a better seller. I'm willing to give it two facings. Now that doesn't work, and this one works. Go figure. No, neither one works. Spread to fill. So obviously we're filling up the hooks. Two-finger rule, not hang loose, hang tight. What we want to do is when you go back and do a reset, I like to start at the bottom shelf. And I put one facing of that product, typically the larger product. Then I put two fingers and I drop a shelf down. Bottom shelf, a big product, maybe three or four, if it's big and it's got a handle you got to get into. But general rule of thumb is two fingers. And the reason is you just need enough room to get in your fingers to face in front. Now, if you have a can section, some people like a little bit more room, but it's just enough room to get in to face in front. If it's too tight, what happens is when you pull that product off, everything comes with it. So it's a common sense kind of thing. It's a general rule. It's not an exact science, but it is a general rule of thumb, two-finger rule, up and down. I had a guy go back to his store, and he had everything spaced two fingers apart like this. And he was so happy he did the two-finger rule. And I said, dude, it's up and down, not left to right. It was hilarious. So I have to make that point now, since I wasn't too clear before. Color block. This is the most, how would you say, powerful and impactful thing that you can do in your store. What we're going to do is we're going to break into teams, okay? Got to figure this one out. All right, you're going to spin around and she's going to be your partner. You two are going to be partners, okay? Lady on the end, you're going to spin around and stand up and meet that guy over there. You two girls are together, okay? You two are together. Okay, you guys, since you sat in the back row, you guys are going to have to move together real quick to do this. Sir, you're going to be my guinea pig, okay? You're going to spin around and meet this young lady here. You're going to meet this gentleman in the golden shirt because he's special, okay? You two are going to do that, and then you and him. Okay, let's see. Sir, you're going to spin around over here. This will be your partner real quick, all right? Gentleman here, right here, you guys are together, you spin around to her. Let's see. Go ahead, introduce yourselves. I think I just pulled out my... Okay. You're going to spin around here, you're going to spin around there. You two together and you two together, right? Right behind you. Now, what I want you to do is introduce yourself. And where your store's from, what do you do? And if you already know the person, ask them something that they don't know. I'm Chris.
I'm John.
John, have we met before? You look very familiar.
We probably did over at Superstore.
Okay, cool. So hopefully you can learn some new stuff?
Yeah, I did.
Good. Thanks for coming back.
Yeah.
Okay, I don't know if you remember this one. All right, don't get too friendly now. Like everybody take their hands like this. And I want you to take your fingers... And I want you to flick it in the face of your partner like this. What do you instantly want to do? You want to hit him, don't you? Don't you? It's annoying as all get out, isn't it? All right, the reason is the eye's the camera. It's always going. And what happens, if you don't color block your merchandise, you got all these buying decisions and all these colors, the eye can't focus in on one that goes, I got to move on. So think about all these buying decisions and how can we group color and block it in our store and then make the eye stop and go, and then move on. Because if it's a sea of merchandise and it's a visual train wreck, the eye just comes in and goes, scans right past everything and moves on. There's nothing to stop the eye. So you go back and look at your sets, you'll find ways to make the eye stop and spend more time. Now, if we ribbon vertically, up and down, what happens is the eye stops and moves down. There's an 80% difference between shin level and eye level in the sellability of the product. How many people have dogs in your store? I mean, stuff you can't sell. Everybody got those? What if I tell you there's no such thing as a dog in a store? There's no bad products in a store. That product was special to you because you bought it and you brought it in and it's not selling. Why? Bad location?
No story.
No story behind it? Bring it up to eye level, put a sign on it, see what happens. Put it into prime real estate. Thank you. You can all spin around now. Now what we want to do with color blocks is I'm going to teach you a couple of secrets tomorrow, make you come back, of how to take a color block, integrate it with store design and lighting, and have it all tie together, how you can triple the impressions in your selling environment. Get people to spend more time and expose them to three times merchandise without spending a nickel by good color blocks and lighting techniques that you can work in over time. Pretty cool, huh? Now, look at the difference between that set by not really color blocking. Drum roll, please. There we go. And we have now color blocked. And we've used the color and leash tiered rack, so we condensed our, got more shell, more product per square inch.
Can you go back? Before, after?
Okay. Now, larger, more expensive item on the right. Why would we want to do that? 80% of the population is right-handed, and there's another reason. The English language is read from left to right. And one of the cool things, if you want to have your staff take the Pet Store Pro program, which is, believe it or not, free, okay, has this whole session so you can have them take this online for free. You don't have to teach it to them, but you have the handout. So you can take a test, you can create your own test, but they have this online. They took a lot of my stuff, and I worked with them last year. So there's great stuff on that Pet Store Pro. How many people do it? What do you think? I have a store that actually set up a workstation in the back for their people. Just a little 2-foot thing with a computer, and they sit down and they take the test right there in the store. Because they don't do it at home. They're too busy on their computer or their whatever. English language is read from left to right, too. So if we have the larger, more expensive to the right, and they read from left to right, where do they end up? Price it on the back or the bottom. Why? So they have to get them to look at it. Manufacturers spend tens of thousands of dollars for labels just so you can put a big old ugly price tag on there. And what happens is you have price tags on everything. Where do they focus to? Price. Rather than features and benefit and value. So they walk in the store, it's price, 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 price. Bring this product out, they go, what's my price? You're conditioning to price rather than features and benefits. And big items on the bottom, lighter above. So you want to create a natural visual curve so the light hits the edge of each shelf. I like to stagger shelves back. There's two reasons for it. One's a design reason. The other is obviously visibility. If we have an aisle that's fairly small and the shelves go straight up and down, my store stops here. But if it tiers back, and it tiers back, I have a visual curve now. I can see that product on the bottom shelf because it's tiered back. So it goes from, say, 30-inch to 28 to 22 to 19 to 16 to 15. So up at eye level, I have a foot more of aisle space. It feels more spacious. Perception. And the light hits the edge of each shelf. Called creating a visual curve. And avoid the Manhattan skyline. This gets very busy to the eye, and the eye cannot focus in on any one thing. What you want to do is not merchandise above the backbone of the shelving. Nice, clean sight lines in your store. Then another thing you can do is to create side stacks. This is a new, it's been around for years, just getting popular again because retail's so tough. Is we take an end cap and we cap it with two sides called power side stacks or impulse. You see it at a lot of supermarkets now. They'll put anything that's small, like a small impulse bagged merchandise. They'll put little shelves in there and put spices, things like that. But it's a great way to add some extra selling space to the store. And then again, tomorrow I'm doing the 25 design and merchandising ideas for retailer. I think it's the next room over at 9:30 to 12:30. So I think we have a stretch break that we're going to skip. Maybe not. So great way to keep up the store, keep it looking good all the time, is to take a picture of your store in 4-foot modules. Just like we cleaned the store in 4-foot modules, now we take a picture of it in 4-foot modules. And I guarantee you, when you take a picture of your store and you look at it, you'll go, ugh, I need to change that. You'll see a lot of wasted space. You'll see it looks different on photography. It really does. Take pictures of your store and look at it. You'll be amazed at what you see. But take pictures of your store, and then you remember that book we're going to start with all the wall units and gondolas all broken down? We key the images to the floor. So now we have this on the back wall so they know what to clean, and then we also have a book that's referenced with photographs of all these different displays. If we have a window display, we change. We can do it by season. We can remember what we did last year. If we did an end cap that was seasonal and it worked really well, we remember what we did last year. Where did we go for Thanksgiving dinner last year? Couldn't tell you. What did we have for dinner? I couldn't tell you. What display we did? I couldn't tell you. But if I go back to my merchandising handbook, I could remember what we did. So we create a merchandising handbook. Create two of them. Why? In case one goes missing, because the staff cannot go home until it looks like the book. Right? Non-negotiable standard. Face in front, store's got to be clean. Every day is grand opening day. Window display, backdrops at windows, creating some fun and some differences. There's a company called Superior Specialties. They have a place in LA and Chicago, and it's all of these types of things that you see that can create some very unique and unusual window displays or end caps or feature displays. Tell a story. Create a focal point. Here's a focal point. Well, we just took some columns and some crown molding, and we did the University of Kentucky Wildcats, and we created a little story. And we'd use mannequins to make it fun. And when season hits here, it's amazing how much of the stuff they sell. Amazing. Do you have any Kentucky Wildcat fans here? You guys take it a little serious over there? I mean, you can roll the sidewalks up when those guys start to play. I mean, it's amazing. What happens? I got to go to a game and I had a blast. Yeah, it was amazing. They say, well, we lost 5 players to the NBA. They're all freshmen. He says, we don't rebuild, we reload. Because they get some great teams. So anyway, standing break, we're going to skip because I talked too much in the first hour. Go figure. And we talked about the things you learned. Now let's talk about layers of signage. There's 3 types of signage in a store. Departmental, directional, and informational. And what we do is small stores, like 2,000 feet, I know I'm standing in front of dog food. You don't have to put it up on the wall. I don't need to know that I'm in that department because I can see it. Departmental signage is really not necessary in small retail stores. Until you get to about 10,000 square feet, then you can have these big, massive categories so I can come in and I can shop your store very easily. However, you can use graphics to display universal language with a dog and a bag of food all sort of happening. It's universal language, lifestyle, and you can have it so it's a fun part of the decor, and that creates that department from a distance, but you don't have to beat people up and say, dog food department, you know, or cat food and all that. So department is really not as important in the small retail sense. And then if you want to add some decor, this is a great way to do it. Again, using the universal language icons and some fins. This is a real tall ceiling, so we had to come up with some ways to fill up this void along the ceilings because we had a 20-foot ceiling. And you'll notice to the left there, you can see the girl's face. She's got a little dog she's holding. So we used some big super graphics. Directional signage again. I'm in a store. You're most likely going to be being helped by a staff member, hopefully, or the owner. You really don't need the directional signage because it's got three aisles, and I can see the whole store like this. I know where I'm at. And you're usually going to get helped by an individual person. So directional signage, small store, is really not that important. So that's obviously aisle ID signs. The strongest one for you to use is informational signage. Now, we mentioned Target or Target. Target hired a lady named Sonia Larson, and she wrote a book, Signs That Sell. And she worked out a signage program for them, and you'll notice their signage program is pretty effective because they have the departmental, they have directional, not so much directional anymore, but informational signage. And informational is down at the product level, typically a 3x5. Typically, it's going to have three bullet points, no more, of features and benefits. Use adjectives to describe action words, adverbs, and have a clear value price point. Why is this special? So staff can be reminded of features and benefits for that particular product, and have some informational signage every 6 to 8 feet in your store. You get too much, it becomes a visual train wreck, and not enough, nothing's on sale, or nothing's special, or manager recommended, or whatever the reason is. End caps, we'll talk about that tomorrow, but I'll talk about how to sign an end cap. But it shows you the size of signs to use in the different areas. End caps, shelf level, case stacks, tonnage statements, big stacks, showcase, maybe if you have showcases or jewelry towers, some smaller type signage for there so it's not overbearing of the product that you're showing off. And there's some tips on the right, so you can take that back. Now, this has been around a long time. I've been doing this session on the next one on staff and employees. Actually, here's some signage. This is oversigned here. See all these little scotch tape on them? That's totally oversigned. That's just too many things yelling at you there. Some visual type signage. We love our customers sitting on the bone bar. Donations, sort of cute. It says, dig up a lower price, we'll match it. She was on a big thing with, they opened up a bunch of stores around her. So she created, this one says, find a price a whisker lower, we'll match it. Find a cheaper price, we'll match it. So there's different types of informational signage. She was on a big bang for price sensitivity, but really it's a small percentage of the population, but it's perceived value. So we need, at product level, use a frame, three features and benefits, have it in a sign frame, and clear value price point, some tips. Now the employee, staff, and customers. This is new. Is calling an ABCD tenancy. I'd like everybody to flip to page 10. And without just clearing your mind, I'd like you to go through and answer these. If it's a definite no, if it's a question mark, or the other no is a maybe, I guess, or yes. So the second no, let's go, that's a maybe. Okay, top of page 10. Let me go back. I got to refresh my memory on this. It's been a while. What's that?
Oh, sorry. I wanted to know if there was more, like, yes, here, maybe.
Must have did a typo there. What did I do? I can't remember. I apologize. Maybe it's sometimes. For the C's. Just go through there and see what your tendency, what tendencies you have. Real quick. Page 10. And then when you get to the bottom, total up each line. Don't think about it too much. Just race through it. First thing comes to your mind. Everybody done? Okay, next page. Has anybody hired somebody and this had total conflict on their floor right away? Has that ever happened to you? What's that? Or they conflict with other people instantly, like personal. Yeah, everybody's had that problem. And it has typically to do with the different types of personalities that are out there. Now, it's not an exact science, but it does help you build a better team and also understand how to sell these different types of personalities. So there's twofold. One is to learn about how to hire different personalities for different job functions and marrying up the people. I do a session called Hatching, Matching, and Detaching. Finding them, training them, and getting rid of them. The thing is we want to find personalities that are going to work well within the scope of their work, whether they're a merchandiser, whether they're sales, whether they're going to be inventory or an administrator or a store manager or whatever. But the A behavior is an amiable, and I've gone through this list of what an amiable is. And amiables are basically talkers. They're ones that come in to buy. They always talk and talk and talk. They want to know the dog's name. They want to know where you live and where you went to school. And they just, you're just waiting for them to take a deep breath so you can interrupt them. They talk so much. Very likable, but what happens is they're not really good for accounting or attention to detail because they're sort of like a dog on, Up? Remember that everybody saw that? Squirrel! You know, they have trouble focusing in on things, and they do a lot of talking. They don't get a lot of things done. If somebody's coming in and they're amiable and they're talking too much, you got to redirect them on how to, what brought you in the store today, Samantha? It's great talking with you, but I got a lot of work today. What brought you in the store today? Let's find out what your needs are. Let's get you going. Because you got to get them redirected on why they came in the store. Sometimes they come in the store and forget even why they came in. So amiables, you got to be careful because they talk a lot, and they're not real focused. And then the B behavior is, we call it the benefactor, the rational, the problem solver. They make good store managers. They're typically pretty good in sales. They can do okay in merchandising, but from a standpoint of accounting, not the best accountants in the world. So you can look at these different people and what you're going to hire them to do, and you can actually give them tests on certain things. I like to give tests, simple tests to find out if somebody has any skills at all. For my front office, I say, here's a computer, here's the Word, Microsoft Word. I need a business letter, one paragraph, what you bring to the table, how can you help my company, here's my business card, I want a business format. Do you know how many people cannot do that? 90% of my applicants cannot do that. One task. Business format, it's like a text. They don't hit spell check. They don't know how to business format to do a simple letter, and they're applying for a job for a front office. So you can create a simple test for that skill. I need you to check in this inventory to this box of goods and see if they can actually match up stuff and check off a list and see if they have a skill. It can be 20 items and see if they can do it. It only takes a couple of minutes, and you're not paying them. So I got a test for you. Well, you did really well on the written exam. Let's try a test and see if they can cut the mustard. So the C behavior is the calculator. The benefactor, I guess, is level-headed. So there's the benefactor, level-headed. The C is the calculating. We call them engineers. Ask a question, ask a question, ask a question. Can't make a decision. They ask 1,000,000,000 questions, and they can't make a decision. What you do have to do is, if they're coming in to buy in your store, you answer all the questions. And did I answer all your questions effectively? Great. This is the best one for you. You have to go to a trial close, and you have to close that type of a personality, the calculating personality. They have to be closed. They will not make a decision on their own. And then D, calculating. Now, D behavior is the driver, we call. Very high self-esteem, make decisions very quickly, and they do not need the long version. You walk in, they go, what's the best one for my dog? You hand it to them, yeah, get me some candy, grab me some treats, and I'm on my way. Here's my American Express card. They're leaving the door open, and the door opens to their car, and it's running. I mean, these do not want the long version, right? If you have a driver coming in, they don't want to fill out the paperwork. They just want the job. But I'd like to get you the job, but I got to see some skills first. I want to see your handwriting skills. That's why you fill this out. I want to give you a couple of tasks. And how would you handle if you're hiring a store manager or somebody for sales and they're a driver personality? You're going to get a lot of conflict. You put two drivers down on your sales floor, all you're going to do is get this all day long. They're going to be competing. They want to be the alpha male. So you got to be careful where you put those in those shifts. And if you have conflict, you can say, they're a driver and they're a driver. I'm not going to put those guys on the floor together again because you're just going to have problems. So you got to train your staff on how to sell and how to find out what type of personality is and then come up with suggestive ways to close. That's why I gave you the five parts to a sale. So the behavior tendency to selling is how can we implement these different personalities. Now, personally, I've had a few beers. I'm an amiable. I like to tell jokes and have a good time. But if I got payroll on Friday, I'm a driver. I'm calling, collecting money. So people change personalities. It's not you're one of these. You change and you morph based upon the stress that's put upon you and what's on your plate during that day. You have to make decisions and have to get things done. So it's just a way of recognizing the behavioral tendencies to either dissolve them or turn them in your favor. I have a management degree. I personally don't like managing people. It's a hard job. But my brother's a manager's manager. And he can push buttons like nobody's business. They can come in all bent out of shape into that his office, and they'll walk out of there going, man, I'm doing that, and I don't even know why, and I'm happy. I was moving my office. Great story. I was moving my office. And he said, Chris, I just sold my business, and why don't I just hang out at your new place, and I'll be there for the painters, electricians, and the carpet guys, and make sure your teledata cables get put in the right place. You got drawings? Yeah, here you go. And he says, I heard through the grapevine your staff is charging you to move. And I said, yeah, I'm paying him overtime, double time. We're moving all weekend. We're going to get the shop moved. Not a problem. He goes, call a meeting. And you're not going to be there. And I go, okay. So I call a meeting. He had everybody over to the new place to show him the new place and what's going on. Everybody got excited. And we had beer and pizza, and I was gone. And he said to everybody, he goes, so what do you think of this place? Pretty cool, yeah. Way better than the other place. He goes, I understand that you're going to be charging Chris to move. Well, yeah. We're getting overtime, yeah. We're going to call weekend, yeah. And he goes, is Chris your friend? And they go, well, yeah. He says, but you'd move your friend for beer and pizza, but you're going to charge Chris to move? Well, that's different. He goes, well, I don't think so. Does Chris ever miss a payroll? No. Does he always give you a cash bonus Christmas? Yeah. Sounds like he's nicer than most of your friends, huh? All of a sudden, when the guy in the back goes, I want Heineken and I want pepperoni. Next person said, I want mushroom and I want Coors Light. Before you know it, they all jumped on board and they all got their favorite beer and pizza and they moved me for free. True story. Learning how to push people's buttons and learning how to manage people. People are good, and you got to find ways to do that. He's incredible. He works at Costco. He's got the number two Costco. Now, he retired, and then he went back to work because he was bored to tears. And he works at a Costco in the front pizza place. They got eight products. They got eight SKUs, $2.5 million, number two in the chain. And they come in. They go, how do you do it? And he goes, you don't pay me enough. He won't tell them how he does it. Number two in profitability and number one in sales or something stupid in Norwalk, California.
So when we move our store, do we have that lecture with our people and say, are you our friend?
Hey, it worked for me.
It worked for me. How do we get him to do it?
It was pretty cool. Okay, five parts to a sale. We're running out of time. I hate to run over. I just got a couple more pointers to do here and we're going to move on. I wish I could tell that Home Depot story. It's so good. Attention. When people walk in our store, we want to get their attention. I'm going to talk about customer care. It's very similar to this tomorrow, but it's a better one. I like this one too. Attention. Get their attention. Hi, how you doing? My name's Chris. I'll be right over here if you need anything. Acknowledge the customer with a simple hi, hello, introduce yourself, and then let that sales wall drop down. Interest. Ask questions. What's a great question to ask?
What kind of pet do you have?
That's not a yes or no question.
They love to talk about their animals.
Oh, what's your pet's name? Oh, what kind of food do you feed them?
Has your pet been in before?
Because you can bring your pet in. We give them a free treat, and we have a watering station.
If they're bringing a baby with them, I usually jokingly ask them, where'd you find that one?
There you go. Talk to the kids. Talk to the animals, talk to the product, ask non-yes, no questions. You can have a contest in your store on what questions to ask that are non-yes, no questions. And you can have them up where they punch in, top three questions to ask customers when they walk in. I like to just introduce myself. Hi, I'm Chris. What's your name? Cool. I'll be over here if you need any help. And then I let them decompress, and then I hit them up again. Action. Once they ask questions, what usually happens is you get the hand product to them. Wow, come on over here, let me show you. Get action happening. Get them enrolled in the sale. Hand product to them. Pull up on a screen and do a comparison on foods. Get some action going. Then, if you keep asking good questions or you're a good listener, desire kicks in. Wow, that's really cool that I can feed my dog half the amount of food. They poop half as much and they live longer. Well, that's pretty cool. Desire kicks in, doesn't it? Once desire's kicked in and they've said the yes word, then it's up to you to do a trial close or a close. That's awesome. Did you want to get some wet food with that? I'll take that up front for you. Here's some great canned food you might want to look at. Let me carry that bag of food up front for you. Assume the sale. So, which one did you prefer? Did you like the red one or the white one? Did you like the salmon? Did you like the smoked? Can I take that up front while you finish your shopping? Is that going to be check, cash, or credit card? Are you on our frequent buyer program? You know, which one was best for you? Try different types of trial closes. You can even have a contest for those. So what we want to do is some value-added goals. Put a story behind the product. We want to cross-train our staff. Create some selling games. My favorite selling game in the world is a dollar scratcher. Whoever gets the biggest add-on sale today gets this dollar scratcher. Everybody's competing for this dollar lotto scratcher for a buck. Everybody's trying to get that add-on sale. Whoever wins gets the dollar scratcher. You're bragging rights. They're under 18. Guess what? I'll go cash it for you.
And how do you keep the office?
You put them under lock and key, or you keep them in your pocket. I had one manager I was training. Oh, upset me to no end. I got him a bunch. I told him what to do. I came back. Okay, I had a list. I want. Who did you give it to, and what did they do? And I came back, and they were all gone. He says, "Oh, I just gave them out to everybody because it was a good day." Really? Needless to say, he didn't work there the following week. Pretty interesting. This is an idea concept I have right here. It says attitude is everything. You can have small ones like this that are non-committal. You can have big, old, loud, proud ones like this. This is a button program called Button Power. See Hi Sam, H-I-S-A-M right there? That stands for Have I Sold Additional Merchandise? Oop, there we go. Do me a favor. Do me a favor, while I'm going to get that food for you, go check out our new collars and leashes and tell me what you think. Turn around, walk away. Do you think they're going to go over and check out those new collars and leashes? Absolutely. Do me a favor, go check out. I did a Harley Davidson store where the t-shirt section was sort of in a non-prime space because we thought it was a good foot traffic draw. It wasn't. So we had a computer screen, screensaver. They'd walk up to the screensaver and said, do me a favor, go buy a t-shirt. And the guy would come in and put the sprocket up there and go, oh, we got that in stock. Do me a favor, go buy a t-shirt, and turn around, walk away. 50% of the people they said that to would go buy a t-shirt, come back. Set it on the counter. Good, I'm helping him. What, you're not married? And they come back with a second one, big old smile. No kids? Went from selling 20 t-shirts a week to 200. One program. People laughing, going, I'm helping him out, doing a good job. You might want to try. Add on sales. You can have a little 5-minute manager meeting in the back. Okay, here's the program. We're going to sell the heck out of greenies or whatever you want to sell. Just try an add on. You might want to try. Create a promotional calendar. How many of you have a promotional calendar? Good. So events, end caps, window displays, take a picture, create a book, and keep a calendar. Keep going after those things and keep it consistent. Change your culture. And then even give backs. Whether you're having an adoption or you're having a fundraiser, great thing to do. What I'd like you to do is to list one or two things in your handout on page 13, 15. One or two things you learned in this session that you're going to promise and go back and implement in your store. One or two things you promise you're going to go back and implement in your store. While you're doing that, just to let you know, we're in booth 1854. We're doing three free 30-minute consults for anybody looking for some help in your store. And Maggie's down the booth. She's got a sign-up sheet. And if I'm not there, that's why. And we'll just go right up one row over to the Marine Land exhibit, what do you call it? The bunch of places to sit down there. We can chat, do some things if you're interested in any services. Make sure everybody fills out their story evaluation. And anybody want to share one or two things you're going to promise and go back and implement in your store? One or two things.
The whole attitude, like just having people being productive constantly all the time.
There you go. You're gonna change your culture. Good.
Photograph sections
of your store. Okay. One or two things you're going to go back and implement. Anybody? One thing you're going to go back and implement? Do me a favor.
Clean more.
Create a cleaning calendar.
Signage
at product level.
Start with
curb appeal. It's important. Traffic flow starts outside. It's 25% of the buying environment. I changed the window display, 40% increase in traffic overnight. People just couldn't believe it. So we got a session tomorrow morning, and my family and I thank you very much for attending. Sorry I ran over. I got a little carried away. Enjoy the show, everybody. Thank you so much.